checking my phone because I texted Jeff, our facilitator, be like, hey. So where we're at is where we're at. And the whole point of this group is to push us, our skills and our resources and knowledge to another level to be able to help in our LEAs. Also, one intent of these groups is that what we come up with, we can also share with the curriculum directors more broadly so that everyone gets to benefit from the work that this group does. So whether those of you that aren't in social emotional learning or personalized learning or MTSS, those groups will also share out their resources so that you could benefit from the groups you aren't in without having to be in every group since they're running concurrently. So we're going to start with just setting some norms for the group. What are some things that you need to have in place to allow you to be in a place that you can be open and share and learn all at the same time? And I'm just going to let us throw some out, and I'll type up some notes on what they are, and we'll use those in future meetings for our norms. We're not going to take a huge amount of time on this, but it is important that we establish the pieces that we can come together around as a group so we feel safe and willing to kind of take risks. That's kind of what this group is going to be, is risk taking. We'll have an expert to help us stay in the out of the danger zones, but we are taking a risk by doing some of this work. Sound okay? Would someone like to throw one out that you think would be valuable?
I think just validating each other. There isn't a silver bullet with all of this. So just validating and being respectful of the individual needs of each district, just seeing how we can blend those together.
What I heard is validating and respecting each other's ideas and opinions, realizing we all have different contexts, which is very true. What might work in one may not, but a lot of what works in one should work across your systems. For quality instruction, for example, works for all children. Okay, what else? And we'll come back and weigh in and make sure there's not one you disagree with.
But. Is there a structure that we'll use for note taking, because there will be times that we might not be able to, you know, people who aren't here and then coming in, it's difficult to catch up sometimes between meetings if you are.
So let's potentially one solution would be we could establish a note taker in the group that would be able to take notes as we go, and then we can disseminate that to the learning team so that if you can't attend, you at least get the essence of what we had with the intent of hopefully being here, but I get conflicts or food poisoning, you know, random stuff that comes that might occur, right? No, it's possible. Okay. What else?
I was thinking pursue good intentions. You don't always have the language to express what you're thinking, so understanding that everyone comes from a good place and that together we'll learn what that means in the context of where we're coming from and how we use language to support ourselves in bringing the work forward as well as in relationship to our students.
Any other thoughts? Right now it's kind of respect and validate each other. But I would also maybe say challenge each other to some level around we are here to take risks. And that we want to get outside our comfort zone, and that's why you're in this group. For most of you, it's like if you knew what to do differently, you'd be doing it. And so we're here to be like, what could I do differently? Taking stock of our current reality and thinking, what could the future reality look like? So I might say something towards risk take or accept the challenge or something to that level. I articulated it so nicely now.
We call it like pushing each other.
Okay.
So, before one of us says something, we say, I'm going to push back a little bit, or just to challenge, just to make you think a different way. Even
in a respectful way.
Yeah. Help, like, push.
Okay.
I'm going
to
push back.
I said, challenge each other to push the work forward, maybe, like to keep us from getting too stuck. Any final thoughts on that?
Also, like, the fact that we have an agenda ahead of time.
To be able to know how to be prepared, or if we, I don't know, maybe establishing an agenda. Mm-hmm. So set clear meetings, including setting the agenda in advance, sending out materials in preparation. Anything else? All right. Okay, so right now we have validating and respecting each other's ideas and opinions. Establish a note taker at each meeting, so it might vary. I'll do the notes today, just that keeps me engaged. I kind of check out sometimes otherwise. that's who I am. Assume positive intentions, challenge each other to push the work forward, and then set clear expectations for meeting. So ending the meeting with setting what's coming in the next meeting. So we have clear direction on where we're going. Okay, so in your opener, you may have hit why you're here, but I really asked you for your background. A couple of you said kind of why you're here, but anything to add in terms of what made you choose this particular group? What are you trying to accomplish? What's the big idea of what you're trying to accomplish? Not the minutia yet, but we'll get there.
One of the things that we talked about this year was maybe making a focus that span across all of our districts and mapping the concern. So one of the things that we talked about resources and how we can join forces together to be able to meet the needs of something. And so this would be a good place to get some information that we can bring back. Here, then we have a lot of reach and that whole. And then I don't know. Maybe she doesn't, but I don't know.
It's always helpful. More brains, the better. Okay, so I heard kind of a group you're in that chose ELs as a focus, and then resources to share, bring back to be able to apply in your own context. Other reasons we're here.
I'm really excited for a framework. Want to start.
Other intentions?
I mean, granted, I'm kind of here subbing. I'm here because my boss told me to be here.
Okay.
So, but
you're welcome with your boss anytime.
Years ago, the district and it has a ton of challenges that come with it. And so I'd like to see how to still find a certain state requirements for to do items, but still do what's best for our commission.
In just within our spheres of influence, right? Being able to change the narrative for ELs from deficit-based to asset-based, and even changing our conversations and in our districts on how we best build from where they're at, from what they are able to do, not what they can do. Just changing that whole narrative as a group will be amazing.
I think to add to that, one of the visions that we have as a department as well is to be strategic and work within the systems that we currently have so that we are moving more towards a tier one instruction rather than the pull out, right? Rather than the parent, rather than those kids, but the more of our kids. Here some things that we can do as a team, mm-hmm. as a PLC, as a school, to really move those students forward, right?
Yep. And honestly, from my work in this space, if you don't address it at tier one, okay. It's insufficient. Yes. So if we think pullout's going to solve the day, it won't. Right. It can help. It can definitely be a lever, but it's insufficient for changing outcomes. It's kind of like special education. If that room could solve problems, you wouldn't have special education students. That's 30 minutes, 60 minutes a day, whatever it is insufficient. You need every teacher addressing their needs throughout the day. That's one thing that we saw that had to change. A lot of that pullout, we still did pullout, but it was to front load for what happened in the classroom rather than something disconnected and disjointed from the work. Okay, anything else to add?
Well, I think in respect to that, it's just identifying those barriers in tier one and how do we address that? Because I think the majority of our teachers really are on board. But they need to know what that looks like and how do we support them.
Professional development, how do we find the best resources to be able to do that?
And using those strategies where kids are, they're able to express what's in here. Because I think a lot of them, you know, we see these, we score LEPs that are high, but then teachers calling and saying they can't read, they can't write. And we know they can, it's in here, it's just helping them express it in a way that they're able to.
Okay, you hit kind of the big gate of what the challenge is with English learners, right? Acquiring what they do know through the mechanisms they can provide at the time, knowing writing is going to be the last in that acquisition phase, right? But in the meantime, if we got more academic conversation in classrooms, it allows them to participate more fully. But also our kids are bored. Like we have a student advisory council that advises the board and they're sick of teachers just talking at them. They would really love to be asked a question and to have some time to discuss and process and take what they're learning and really understand and make meaning. And right now, a lot of our classrooms aren't providing that opportunity, not saying all, but many are more of a teacher is talking, especially in the secondary setting and kids are listening.
Hello, everyone. You hear me?
Oh, is this Jeff?
Yes.
Jeff, I've done a wonderful job leading this meeting. I just want you to know.
I realized about 10 seconds ago that there's a time change.
I had a feeling that's probably what it was.
I am so sorry.
Not to show up. That's okay. If you're looking at your screens, you can see Jeff. Welcome. We're glad to have you. We have done introductions. We were just going through kind of why we're here. So I'm going to summarize that for you so we can move into the 1:30 part of the agenda. So just so you know, we're basically there. We started a little late with some technology and that kind of thing. So here we go. This is for Jeff's benefit, but also for you to check my summary abilities of what you shared. One group in particular has, they work with a consortium of LEAs and they chose ELs as a focus area to address in their systems, knowing that all of them are struggling in the space of English learners. One potential reason they're here is for resources to share and bring back and consider within their context of how they might use that and leverage that in their systems. Looking for a framework, like what are those key components that we want to consider when we're addressing the needs of English learners? And then complying with some of our state requirements for dual language immersion, and you and I can talk about that offline to let you know what that might look like. But while still supporting our English learners in those dual settings adequately, we have some very specific timelines and content demands in our dual immersion settings that I'll talk with you off base for in preparation for the next one. And then helping to change the narrative, like how do we work within the systems we already have rather than trying to create a new system, but how do we dovetail into what's already happening and just make some adjustments to the current system without having to overhaul and make people think we're doing way different things. So for example, how do we embed ourselves in core instruction rather than pull out systems for English learners? And what does that look like? And then identifying the barriers in tier one and what supports are needed to help overcome those barriers, including what professional learning opportunities might be of benefit to their teachers. And then we're really trying to get kids' ability to express their thinking, both verbally in preparation for like reading and writing, and opportunities to help students engage that way. So those are kind of the reasons why they're all here. Which all kind of weave together as kind of one cohesive unit. But I'll send you the notes after the meeting for your own processing. I know. And we set norms, which are just to validate and respect each other's opinions. We are establishing a note taker each meeting so that the notes can go out after the meeting, so people can kind of keep up or refresh what they learned. We're assuming positive intentions about, you know, any choice words we bring out in this space. We're going to challenge each other also to push the work forward. So when we're kind of have moments where we need to kind of challenge and give a good push, keep things going, and then setting clear expectations. So this one's going to be kind of with you, Jeff. They would like to kind of have an idea of what the next agenda will look like at the end of each meeting. So thinking about what we covered just now, what makes sense for heading into the next meeting, and kind of having a somewhat established agenda in terms of topics of what we would address next time each.
Okay.
Time.
Okay.
Just for your own, but I'll send the notes to you in the meantime. So.
Okay.
Jeff, do you want to introduce yourself and give them a little background about you before we turn things over for you to lead?
Yeah. My name is Jeff Zwiers, and I'm called a senior researcher at Stanford, but I don't do as much research as I do getting into schools and doing professional development. And mostly, it was exciting. Not a lot of people get really excited about the topics you just mentioned, but those are the topics I work on. I tend to work on areas where there are diverse learners, multilingual students, and also especially places who want to increase the quantity and quality of conversation and interaction in the classroom to work on oral language especially. But I also kind of work across the board in all the language modes. That's kind of what I do is I go in, I do a lot of teacher kind of co-teaching. And part of that is to work with the teachers, but part of it's for me to learn how are students learning. And one of the things, and I'll get into it in a little bit, very shortly, will be, like you said, not completely changing everything, but working within what we have, still making some major pushes, but not throwing everything out. And so I think one of the things I'm hoping that will come up from this that you'll be interested in is how do we really develop language and content at the same time, especially for English learners, but also for everyone in the classroom, especially in these heterogeneous classrooms. So that's a little, tiny bit of my, background, and I can share more later, but I hope that enough for now? I'm hoping that's enough for now.
I have turned my mic back on and they said yes.
Okay.
Because when my mic's on, it makes you funky, so.
Oh, okay. Is it possible to see everyone, or is that not going to be possible? I think we talked about that before, but is that probably not going to be possible?
Rough morning.
It should be. You guys are showing the whole room a minute ago.
It's been a rough tech morning, you mean?
Yeah. So can you not see the three different screens?
Let me see. What am I looking at? I can see. Nothing shows up in the middle. I have, I see Anya Becerra down below. That's it. So.
Well, it could be, I have my camera. Like, we all had our cameras.
Okay. But there's nothing shows up in the middle. So I just have, I see myself and I see Anya.
I don't know if
she's
connected.
Well, if you're willing to put your camera on just so you can see your face, but then.
It's okay if not.
Yeah.
How about that, Jeff? There's nobody at the wall right now because that's my spot. But
oh, okay. No, I still it's the same. It hasn't changed. And I have Jennifer, Christine, Annalise, Amanda, and Melissa, and that's all I have down below. So I'm trying to. So maybe it's something on my end. I don't know.
Jeff, you and I might even do a training on WebEx.
What?
Have a whole column of participants.
I haven't. I haven't done WebEx in a long time, so I usually use Zoom. So that's probably part of it.
Perfectly.
Well, so can you see me? Can you see me? Can you see me?
Yeah. We can see
okay.
You really well.
Oh yeah, that's fine. You don't see my nose hairs though. Right?
No, not that well. We're good.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, and then share. I, I think what I can do now is I can start sharing my screen. Does that sound all right? Okay.
Most you should give him privileges to do that. Do you know how to do that? One moment, Jeff, we have to give you the rights
okay.
to use.
Okay.
I do not know how to do that.
Okay.
I'm doing this through the web browser too, which could make a difference. I didn't have time to download the, when I realized my, the error of my ways, I thought I would just get on as quickly as possible.
All right, now Jeff, in the middle of your screen, there should be like a microphone, a camera.
Yeah.
That is the shared screen thing. Do you see that?
Okay, yeah. I don't see the, which one is the shared screen thing? Is that the thing with the arrow? Yeah, it must be.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I think you're gonna have to give me a second. Give me 1 minute or less, hopefully less. I'm downloading. Sorry, I'm downloading the desktop app. If I had been on time, I would have done this all beforehand. But
well, you came early for your time. I always forget that.
Hopefully, I didn't miss too much.
You just don't know who anyone in the room is. Other than that, you should be. Okay.
Sorry.
No, you're good. Hoping you're still going
to work. Okay. This now I have. Okay. This. A little more power now, I think.
Okay, power is always good.
All right, so I'm going to share my. I'm going to see if I can share my screen.
Woo! Success, my friends. Yeah. You okay, see slides.
Are you still seeing it?
Yes.
Okay, you're still seeing slides. Okay, good. So let's start with. Now there's a little bit of echo. Is that me or you guys?
Just fixed it, I think.
It's definitely not a. It was me.
Okay.
We had one participant get a little excited.
All right. Audio and visual are okay now?
We can see you. The sound is a little low.
Yeah. We have to do sound on ours.
No, it's here, but I'm full up, and he was good until just now.
Oh, how about now? Is that better?
Nope.
Is it projecting through this? Is that?
It's through the owl.
Can you turn that up?
It is.
If there's no delay, like on the bottom, I think over here.
Well, if you turn yours on, it will. Feedback will be the problem.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Talk to me.
Let me try to turn up my mic and see what happens.
I'm turning you up here. I think we're okay.
Is that okay?
Speak to me.
Okay, how's that? I'm speaking now. I can speak louder.
That's good.
If you, is that good? Is that good?
Louder and yeah, I think we're good. We can cuddle in everyone. That's what I call it. It's inappropriate.
I can get a little closer too, and I can scream into the computer too. How's that? Is that good?
Yep, yeah. That was good.
All right, so. We've already skipped over a couple things. We're into the creating a foundation for serving English learners. And this is a really, and most of you, this is a review for a lot of you, but I want to at least go over a quick review of language acquisition. And it's most effective, and most of you already know this, but sometimes it doesn't get out into the classrooms. For some reason, there's sometimes the sound theory doesn't make it into practice. And so one of the things that I've been working on lately, and not just me, but a lot of, and some people have been working on it for 100 years, is using language authentically, to authentically communicate. And this means both, you know, read, write, listen, speak, converse. It's not just speaking, or it's not just writing, but it's also, am I reading to communicate authentically, or am I just reading for points? So one of the things that I think, you know, we need to look at is, how much are kids doing things to communicate, and how much are they doing it because this is what school says, or this is what we're supposed to do in school, or this is for points, or this is for grades. Because, you know, typically you're going to get a lot more lasting language learning if it's actually to communicate. And there's several features. I mean, one is to get things done. So if they're communicating to actually do things like get to the bathroom, right? You learn pretty quickly some of the language to do, you know, to get things done. And then the other things that are a little more on the kind of where we're going to be at is in the academic sphere is building up interesting and important ideas. And this is something that sometimes it seems obvious. Oh yeah, they're supposed to build up ideas. And then sometimes they actually do have an idea like in the beginning of a unit, but then it doesn't get followed up on. It doesn't get built up as well as it could. So one of the things that we're looking at is how do we get kids, even in early, you know, beginning classes, I know it's harder because it's so tempting to just drill through grammar and drill through vocabulary, but how do we you know, get kids and build up instruction and support teacher practices that help kids use language to do this idea building? And that's, I'm not saying this is the be all end all here, but I just wanted to share kind of the most recent work that I've been doing around language acquisition has been on this. And then the final thing, it's also to fill information gaps. So if students are just answering a question to look good or to make the teacher happy or to get points again, rather than actually filling in an information gap that's needed, like language was invented to actually fill information gaps. If you're not doing that, then it's just, often it's going to be bare minimum, or it's not going to stick as well in the brain because it's not that important. But if you really want to know what I'm saying and what I'm thinking, and I really want you to know, I'm going to work a lot harder. And I might say a second sentence, if you can believe that, in a pair share, rather than just one sentence or just one word or just one phrase. So what I've been looking at lately is how do we get more talk time, which means more sentences, doesn't have to be complete sentences, but just more language that comes out of kids and also comes into kids authentically. And that's where you're going to get a lot of accelerated language growth. Now, I'll stop there just for a little while. Any questions or clarifications? So far, no. I just wanted to...
How are you seeing your teachers do this for any child?
For any child?
For the group, Jeff, more than anything. But like, what's the current practice around trying to fill information gaps or building up through interest and kind of relevance for kids?
Well,
challenge for all children.
Yeah. No, and again, that's who I usually work with. I work with heterogeneous classrooms, content teachers, and they have a lot of kids. They have a lot of kids, you know, that are language learners or not classified yet, but they have a lot of a ways to go language wise. And these actually apply to those settings. It's not just ESL classes. So, for example, if you have a jigsaw, which has a lot of potential for, and especially already has that information gap piece, because everyone reads a different, and we do this in our, you know, teacher trainings too, right? If you have an information, but if kids think that the sole purpose is to get points from a chart they're filling in, like, so they get back to their home groups and everyone shares their different summary or whatever. And usually they actually just pass it around and copy off of each other rather than actually talking. But let's say they do actually talk. It's usually pretty minimum if they don't have an important or interesting idea to build up as a result. So if I don't really want or care about your information, yeah, I'll nod my head. I'll take a note or two. But my main purpose is to fill in this little piece of paper, not to build up ideas. So if we can turn that around, and if in the teacher's mind thinks, you know what, through this jigsaw, they're going to build up the idea of animals adapt to survive, right? And maybe people did get a different card with different animals on it. I just did this activity yesterday. So They get a different card, but the purpose is to build up the idea, not to just memorize a couple of different animals or show some chart that I've done, right? The same thing with doing a grammar activity. If it is just to cover a standard, that's not nearly as powerful as if you teach me some grammar that's actually useful to communicate a thought or to get communicated to, right? If the information gap is, so you need kind of both together. You need to build up the ideas, but you also need the information gaps. If you're missing one or the other, there isn't going to be as much rich language, typically. And this goes for, you know, you could be in high school physics. I mean, you could argue, okay, well, are we building up an important idea here by doing this lab or even doing this reading of the text, an article, we're reading an article. Are we building up an important idea? And then if kids are doing something, are they actually filling information gaps, or are you just telling kids summarize the article to one another? Well, I read the article, you read the article, we don't really need to use a whole lot of good speaking and listening. That's kind of the example there. Any other? I mean, I know that's not like I completely answered the question, but.
Well, I think my question for the participants is, how are you seeing this, that kind of language learning? Because language learning is for all students. And
right.
From my experience, if I could sell it like this will benefit all your children, teachers would do it. Then if I was like, this is for the two ELs in your class that they had a struggle point of serving because there wasn't mass, right? So giving them instructional practices that are appropriate for all, although will serve our English learners very well.
Yeah.
So just curious about the commentary in the room. So let's start.
So we've gone through a mass.
Oh, I think your mic is on again.
It keeps doing that. Like,
loves her mic.
We've had a massive structural, you know, change in our district, and a lot of work that we were able to do for elementary last year. Secondary was a bit on a pause, but for the elementary level, I've been working with ELL for many, many years, and that's just something that's been part of my passion. But what you see in classrooms a lot is twofold. You'll see exactly what, you know, obviously he's saying, but you have the teachers who almost think, and I've seen this many times, need to be given that permission to have the conversation, to have noise levels that are appropriate for what all the students are needing and deserving. So you have that part of it. The other aspect that I'm seeing a lot of too are the limitations that students are feeling, but it's that some of that is cultural. Where the culture climate of behavior in classroom kind of sets the tone for how the student feels that they need to behave. And so they need to also be given that permission to be allowed to talk about topics that interest them. And so with those two pieces and balancing it out, it's a dynamic that's very difficult to cross over. I think in just seeing this in the last year with our district, it's been exciting to see some classes bridge that. And when that happens, you are able to do what he's saying, and it's exciting. Now, secondary is our focus this year, and that is a whole different ballgame. Mm-hmm. And I'm just glad to be here to get some ideas. That's my why. And so I'm glad I was asked to come up.
Well, that will be something as we, later in the session today, we'll be talking about what do we want to do? And we might have to identify what is the target population that we're wanting to serve. Is it elementary? Is it secondary? Is it K-12? Like, how are we orienting our work? And maybe some of us are going to work on one and some of us are going to work. So there, just be keeping that in mind. We're going to frame this however makes sense in terms of a structure of how we get stuff done, whatever this group ends up prioritizing. So as I told the curriculum directors in preparation for this, I have no driven agenda for you other than to create the conditions for you to be here. And so giving you an expert, letting you have your own expertise shared in this space, what your intentions are will be what the group will define soon. So just keeping this in mind is if language learning happens through these types of circumstances, how might that influence something that we might need to learn about to be able to have that influence? Or is that something we already have going in our schools? As he was talking, I was like, I don't see a lot of those opportunities occurring in classrooms personally, but.
I think the other thing that's really interesting probably is up your alley is, you know, ELI. So we have six languages in our district, and just recently I was having a conversation with the principal about language objectives and learning objectives. Mm-hmm. And he's a new principal, and he said, oh, I should talk to my DLI folks. I'm like, no, this isn't faculty, this is all folks. And I think that's the bridge right there that we were talking about is, you know, we need to stop looking at that. Like, why don't all of our kids would benefit from language learning, regardless of their background? But yet, we don't really look at it that way.
Yeah.
We have that learning objective. Where are we scaffolding the language for? And I think if we could show that as good teaching, regardless, best practice for all teachers, I think we'd see more freedoms happening with what you're talking about. And I think, again, to echo, and we get to high school, and that's a whole other ballgame, because they don't see them as writing teachers unless they're an English teacher. They don't see them as, you know, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so one of the things to consider, and this is a lot of what I've been doing, is I try to do two things. One is we can present strategies that are kind of concrete and visible, and you do them in whatever setting, and then the teachers see that, whoa, that's not just an English learner strategy, that's not just a language strategy. So that's one. And another thing is then to take, like I did with the jigsaw, something I'm already doing, but enhance it and like make it more powerful for language, particularly with communication. So you know, if you in your districts were to go in, or especially if you had coaches and principals, and whenever you have supervisors that actually go into classrooms, looking for, hey, here's, you know, I noticed you did this activity. Here are some ways to make it more authentic in terms of the communication. You know, it's one direction. I'm not saying that we have to take that direction, but that's one of the things that I have been spending a lot of time on in the last couple of years is, not just, you know, here's a few strategies, but also getting into that foundation of here's, you know, when we're designing and tweaking and enhancing strategies for our students, what do we do around the communication side of it? So that's just one thing that, you know, one thing we can, you know, consider as I move on. I forgot what's on the rest of the slide, so I'm going to bop it up. Okay. Is that okay if we keep going?
Yeah.
Together. Feel free to raise your hand. I only see about four people, but
this is going to be a group you just talk.
So the other one is, and I've already, you know, we've already talked about that, and you have too, frequently interact face to face with others. And for this, facet of this is paired conversation. You mentioned earlier, you know, some kids don't feel safe. A lot of don't feel safe to share even in a whole group. So I've tend to, you know, figure out how do we get the activities, a lot of paired work, either as an activity or within the activity. So a lot of paired face-to-face, working on eye contact, speaking and listening and conversation. I think that's what you mentioned earlier, right? Jennifer was...
Yeah. What I learned, at least around my English learning pieces, is without the interaction, they don't have the ability to practice what they're learning in a language-based way. And if you're going to build language for speaking, that's going to help with reading and writing at the same. Yeah. And so that peer interaction, one, guess who else it benefits? The other child in the peer interaction. Yeah. And it gets that student talk ratio up and lowers the teacher talk ratio and allows kids to process the information and navigate for meaning in a way that if you're just telling me doesn't allow me to negotiate what I'm understanding.
Right.
So that academic conversation, as we kind of think about where we go, Jeff is definitely an expert in academic conversation. I don't want you to feel limited by academic conversation. Jeff is multifaceted, and we can also bring in other resources as needed. But in terms of if you want to change the outcome for English learners, they have to have an opportunity to negotiate for meaning. And that's going to be best through writing and speaking in terms of their ability to have input and output. Right? So reading is just an input. But when I write or I speak about what I read, that's that output. And our English learners need a lot more output. When they do studies, Jeff, I don't know if the studies have been redone, but like the number of minutes an English learner speaks in a school day is like 2 minutes or something. Yeah. That's insufficient for practice, my friend. So
it doesn't meet the 10,000 hour criterion, right?
an academic conversation, not saying they're not interacting socially, but as an academic conversation, it is less than 2 minutes a day.
Yeah.
At least the research I've seen, and Jeff, you're much more skilled in that area, but if you really look at kids, you can see that, because English learners are not the first to opt in most of the time for like a raise their hand, but the peer interaction sets me up in a safe environment, because it's only one other person hearing me speak, and it's pretty intimidating if you're not proficient in a language to speak to a full class, right? So the partnership allows practice, allows that negotiation without the threat of 30 kids listening to me. And so those peer interactions really matter in an English learner
setting,
but it benefits all children to talk about what they're learning.
Yeah. And there's also an issue of quality too. At some levels, some places, schools, teachers need to realize that a pair share is not a conversation. So that's one differentiation. A pair share is output and input, somewhat speaking and listening, and it's fine as long as you realize that and you use it for that purpose. Because if you just think, they're sharing in pairs, they're a conversation, I'm going to check that off, that's not the same. Often what happens, and I'll ask this as a question, do you have students who are pretty good at being quiet for 12 years in school? And
they
so
nodding their heads and laughing.
Some of the kids that I'm and again, some kids do fine even if they don't talk a whole lot, but I think are probably most concerned about the kids who don't do fine, and partially because they're not putting their ideas into words, or not really processing using the language for meaningful purposes. And so they can hide in a pair share really easily. They go second, they say ditto, or you stole my idea, and that's it. So imagine, or they say one sentence. Now imagine doing that for 12 years. The difference between that kid who says one sentence and the kid or the same kid who says three sentences every time there's a pair share. There's a big difference. That 1 week isn't a big difference, but 12 years makes a huge difference. So that's kind of, I'm hoping that's where what we're looking at. So any comments on that? Questions?
I think it's a secondary level, and I'm not like any laugh, but this is kind of all I know. But a lot of everything, every word, the word that sticks out the most is the authentically communicate. And so I think all of these things are very, when we think authentically, we're thinking maybe in the context of content area or academically, so what's authentic to us. But I think, and I'm sure it's for all students, but at secondary, if it's not authentic to the kid and they can't internalize it, nothing is going to come out. They're not going to, no matter what it is. So I think finding what's authentic to them, and giving teachers the power to figure that out, even if they can't speak the same language,
mm-hmm.
or they can, giving them the tools to bridge that so they can figure out what's authentic to get here. Because in secondary, they're already going through so much that I think the content is going to come after the authenticity.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that's how, that I think sometimes we think authentic communication is these domains, but when they're growing so much in such a short time, it's almost what's authentic to them,
mm-hmm.
and then going as a stepping stone. But that's what, I think I've
relevant
yeah.
for them, yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. It's hard when you come in as a sophomore and you've never been in English speaking
right.
country.
So. Yeah, yeah. I think I have one more here. Receive linguistic supports and scaffolds that help them communicate. Now I should have underlined the last part, because the first part, especially in ESL type settings or whatever structured, I don't know if you have SADAI or sheltered settings where you group students. And a lot of that is, it doesn't help them communicate. It helps us see that they're learning verb tenses. But if it's not really helping them do the things up above, like authentically build important ideas or authentically fill information gaps, then again, it's not going to last as long. Some things might linger, but if you're not using it, and I was going to get back to in these last two points, think about a 4-year-old or a 5-year-old. They don't learn any grammar, they don't learn any, you know, vocabulary list necessarily. Most of them don't. And yet by age five, they're extremely fluent, right? And it's not like it's because they didn't have a first language to get in their way. It's because they used language to build up important ideas and to get things done. Those two, and to fill information gaps, right? Those three points up there. So, and I sometimes get in trouble for saying this from certain, you know, from different language people, but I don't think the brain changed a whole lot from that initial way of learning language. I don't think the brain suddenly changed over to say, oh, you know what? Now I'm just going to memorize grammar and vocabulary and put it together. And that's going to be the way of learning. So I'm a little bit on the radical side of the communication spectrum, let's say. But I honestly think that, and so part of this is all my observations of ESL classes, kids are bored because they're just doing these language-based activities and they're not really doing interesting things, getting things done or building up cool ideas in the language. So I don't know if this is helpful in all this kind of background or basis, but there are some practical things we can do, you know, around choosing strategies, enhancing strategies. Our assessments at the end, is the assessment just a test or are there other things? Is it some kind of interesting performance task that kids are going to have to use language for in some way? And a lot of you have probably seen students don't do much because they're not interested, and then suddenly boom, they produce all this language, or they really try to produce all this language because suddenly they're building up some idea or trying to get something interesting done with the language. And that's what I think we need to get more of. Not that we're going to get 100% because we have so many kids, but we just to get more of, right? And I think that's why we're here, right? To get more of that going.
Jeff, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I was just thinking, putting this in conversation with 21st century skills or deep learning, college and career readiness, when we're thinking about collaboration, communication, critical thinking, and all of that. Mm-hmm. That's a big push in our district. They call it the deep learning, the 6 C's.
4 C's.
And that has been a way in for us to be part of the conversation. When we look at collaboration and communication, what does that really mean for all students? And how do all students really benefit, but especially our English language learners? And so it's been a great opportunity for us to begin to be part of that conversation and sort of help them unpack what that means in the context of their tier one instruction in developing those competencies across content areas and context, right? Various grade levels, and how do we build those skills over time, starting with kindergarten versus waiting until whatever, you know what I mean? that just makes me think, but especially because a lot of the literature that's coming out on English learners lately has changed the narrative as to how do we increase the rigor, how do we amplify the curriculum to support them at high levels of rigor, high levels of challenge, but also providing high supports.
Yeah, I agree. And those the 4 C's, I forgot, I don't have them memorized, but I think it's critical thinking, collaboration, communication, and creativity. Yeah. And so, all of those are engaging and important for this type of work, right? You know, obviously, communication is already there, but collaboration. So I'm working with someone else. It's actually hard to communicate without having someone else. But at the same time, to learn how to collaborate is also not the same as communication, right? Because some people are very good at communicating, but they're terrible collaborators. And so learning all that, but all that, again, if you know, in my mind, and I'm a little obsessed with this, but it fits around getting things done and building up ideas. So if I'm going to teach critical thinking skills, and if I have a kid say, well, why do I need to do that? Why do I need to make, interpretations? Or why do I need to evaluate the weight of evidence? I said, well, it's in order to be able to make decisions and, build up ideas on both sides of an argument so you can actually make an objective decision and not just make a highly biased decision. That's the critical thinking that's involved there. So, and all of that, requires good language, rich language, that deeper, deeper learning language that you mentioned. So I think it falls in line very well, as long as people are not just, okay, this is a critical thinking skill, I'm just going to teach it as a skill. It also, kids need to see that it's useful for getting things done and building up ideas. Learning skills for a lot of kids is like, whatever, right? Okay, here's another skill I have to learn. I have to learn how to inference. They don't really, if you just say, no, you got to learn it because it's in the standards, that's different than saying, no, you got to learn it because it really helps you figure out life lessons or fill in the blanks that authors don't always include in their texts. Because when you and here's some important texts about whatever, but you're really trying to build up to that higher level of idea rather than just this, hey, let's, the broad, scattered, often disconnected things that you have to learn and memorize. And that's what kids are often kind of focused on. So I'm going to move on if that's okay. Sorry, Dan. I think
for the sake of pace.
So I was going to have all these pop. I just quickly go over the Portrait of a Graduate, right? Which I think is fantastic. You have all these. I didn't count them up. You have a lot of great stuff, right? And these are. I don't know what you call them, but they're.
We are calling them elements.
Elements.
That would soon be defined by competencies, but right now they're elements.
I like elements a little better, but. These, and if you look at, you see that the four yellow ones are the four C's we just mentioned, right? Mm-hmm. And then so there's some other ones that are more tested than others, and sometimes they receive, like academic mastery, obviously probably gets the most testing, I would assume, right? And then the others kind of, the others are there, but maybe tested individually in some of the courses. But I just want to, I have a couple questions. For example, how does language development foster these? It's just a reflection question. I don't, someone can answer it if they want, but if we went through every single one, it would take us till tonight. So I just wanted to bring language into these things. How does language development foster these? We develop language in order to do better at a lot of these things, right? Even if you look at any single one, like even respect, well, my language is stronger at showing how I respect others' ideas and how I respect others, how they live and do and think things. And yes, it's a powerful thing. Now, the second question, of course, is how do these foster language development? Because we're working on these throughout the 13 years of school, right? And so a reflection question was, how can I leverage these in a way to foster as much language development as I can? So when they're doing a service project, or what else would be, what's an example of some of the stuff that, digital literacy, how do I use that knowledge and that whatever activities and products or projects or practices, how do I use those in whatever class it is or setting to also foster their language development?
And that is what we'll work on. Right, everyone? Having been in CD meeting this morning.
So anyway, does anyone have any comments, questions? I just want to lay that out there.
I think some of them come with some of these. So seeing what they have and how they can articulate that through language and how far they can go in each one of them, and then building off that to start with another, but seeing, not assuming that they don't know anything about any of them, but seeing how far they can communicate with language,
mm-hmm.
how far they're developed and what they have in them, and starting from there.
Yeah, I think it's wonderful having all these things that are at the same, in a sense, the same size right now as academic mastery, because a lot of times you'll, you know, you go into a classroom and it's just focused on, I got to improve the test scores. And some of these other things get shoved on the side, right? And I'm not saying, you know, we don't also work on test scores, but I'm also saying, hey, there's a lot more to the graduate than increased test scores.
But I think that's why your question is a follow-up to the question that you have this morning.
There's something. There's a lot of
work. Yeah. These mics on. Let's see who it is. Hold on.
We're good. Okay,
so
he's
just gonna
question.
The perpetrator.
Don't have to be me.
Call it out. No, you don't.
Oh, Jerry. Okay, we are good to go back now. You should be able to hear us. Okay,
sorry about that. Sorry.
No, I'm glad you said something. It sounded like Russian.
Well, I heard a cough before. I was like, it's a man.
Where's the man? Oh, Jerry.
I think your question is super valid because some of these, academic mastery, we know, not saying we do it well or it's correct,
but we
know how to create an accountability system on that. We try to with civics.
We try to with general.
But when it comes to wellness, when it comes to collaboration, when it comes to responsibility, what is our gauge? You know, how do you look at that? And I think that's the conversation, just as language development is in this, is what does it look like? What does it sound like? What is it that we're looking for? I'd rather see a student taking risks with language in their development than being fearful that it has to be perfect all the time. Right. And so, you know, I don't want to look at it the way we look at academic mastery, because we just cut and dry black and white, and I don't think language development is that.
And this is a little small example, but how much do we value the super creative idea that came up that had a lot of flawed language in it, versus the highly perfect grammar idea that was just flat or copied from someone else?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So a lot of times we value the, you know, the second one because, oh, well, you know, it's language. It's about not having mistakes. And yet, so what happened to the, so anyway, that's why I like this. It can actually bring value to these other highly important things. And in fact, if you look at a lot of them and you look at what both universities and employers are looking for, you know, a lot of those would be bigger, if you blew them up by importance, would be bigger than the academic mastery. Right? The communication is always up there, number one, two, or three. They don't want people who can't communicate. You can have a great idea even, and if you can't communicate it, they don't, you know, or if you can't get along with people, right? So there's just a lot of things that I think, and I've seen extremes and, you know, in around the country of, this hyper focus on academic mastery, and even if you pull back, you could actually rephrase it for some of these places. It's just raising test scores at all costs, and I'm glad you guys are focusing on this. And I just wanted to bring this up because I think language can thrive when we're focusing on when we're working on all these things and not just academic mastery. I'll put it that way. So it's exciting to see that. I know it looks different in different settings, but so I'm going to move on. I also wanted to include just this part of the Utah strategic plan, because what I didn't do in the very beginning, I don't think, maybe I'm about to do it, but is I want you, you know, part of this meeting, or a big part of this meeting, like Jennifer said, is to come up, is to narrow down some of the things that we really want to focus on. Which I would call our high leverage, high need, right? What are the high need things that we're looking at that we can also have some high leverage on? And one of the things that we, you know, that I just selected out, doesn't have to be this one, but it's just how do we improve some of the teaching and the leadership around that teaching that's going on in the classroom? So you can just take a quick look at it. I mean, you've seen it all before, but you know, we're looking at providing professional learning for teachers. That's 2B. Effective mentoring, which is somewhat similar for both beginning teacher and educators. And that's the PD side of things, right? And then you're looking at, I don't know how much you'll be able to influence the teacher educator programs. I know I've tried and failed. But, and then, you know, I really like the 2D is a biggie in my mind, lead in changing the perception of teaching. Now that might be some from an outside perspective, but I also think that we need to, you know, change the perception of what I am as a, you know, what do I do as a teacher? Because sometimes it gets worse and sometimes it gets better, but in terms of what I do, what, you know, it's about pedagogy. And if I'm just focusing on, and I've seen teachers do this. They've had a minimal teacher ed program, and they were coming in and trying to raise test scores, and that was it. And that's what they saw themselves as a teacher. I'm just here to transmit information into kids so they can, you know, make good, you know, A, B, C, D choices. And that's a lot different than someone who has, as like, I care about doing all those, whatever, 14 things on the previous page. And building up students' language and building them, you know, each kid up as much as possible through what we do in our classroom, right? So there's these different, you know, ideas of what is learning and what is pedagogy. So I know that's probably what, that's not what it was meant in 2D, but I just wanted to throw that in there, if that's okay. Any other, like, additional comments that, again, you might, like, look back at this and connect to this when we're making some of the decisions later on today.
Yeah, and I think that's how I might frame between the portrait of a graduate and strategic plan. Are there connections? Are it just getting into some thinking points around these are the work that the state's going to continue down. And so knowing that we're going to focus on communication, collaboration, problem solving, and all of those things as part of implementing portrait of a graduate, as well as we're trying to improve teachers in their practice as well as leaders. Are there things that this group wants to establish? So thinking about, is it looking at the endorsement and what's provided there? Or is it really thinking about classroom instruction, what our teachers are doing? Is it about educator preparation? Like, there's all so many facets this could go. And so kind of just planting the seeds with a couple of those documents to think about in relation to what you're going to be asked to do as leaders within Portrait of a Graduate as we move towards a competency-based instructional expectation. And then as we look at, you know, where we're investing our time and dollars and resources at the state level, are there any connections there that make sense? And if not, great, but just trying to, like, give you the big picture, I guess, from a state perspective around where we see some of this work could easily tie and drive into. But ultimately, this is driven by what you want it to be. And so just kind of creating some context and maybe some shifts in even maybe your thinking. You may not have come in today knowing exactly what product you wanted. Russ came in, he needs a framework. Like, is that something we want to consider? The State Board is working on creating a quality instruction framework, trying to show how MTSS, Universal Design for Learning, and some of our, all these other models we have at the state, how do they actually work together to create a coherent quality instruction model? We'll be developing something like that. And that could potentially be used in these conversations with teachers around, like, scaffolding for instruction. Like, what are the five? Yeah.
Okay. It's written the exact same way in Texas until this very moment. 10 years then, I did never read it.
Okay.
But on 2E, is it, now that we're having all this conversation about tier one instruction and all kids and all teachers, wouldn't it be, tell me what your thoughts on pushback, like, reversed of making highly effective teachers equitable or accessible versus making,
I can just give you a little context for E. When we looked at data for, like, Title I schools, for example, they had less years served, less experienced teachers serving in those settings, so lots of newbies, right? Yeah. And so this is getting LEAs to look at how are you placing teachers and how do people promote into, most people try and move out of a Title I school, but that's not, doesn't serve the kids well, right? Like, we have the least experienced teachers. What we found is that they're effective if they were in a building for at least 3 years straight. And so even if they're a Title I new teacher, being in the same school for 3 years seems to have major impact on student outcomes. So trying to get retention of teachers in those buildings seems to be the more highly effective part, that they work better and outcomes are better for kids when they live in a system rather than moving around. So some LEAs like to move teachers, some really make it really easy to keep moving. North Summit, he's not worried about this. Not a whole lot of options. Feel free to move. See you in an hour. Like this is not a thing.
I was just thinking, I know why it's really good. I just was thinking as a tier one in all students.
Right.
I get why it's written that way as far as like structural logistics and things. But it might, I mean, just reading it, I feel like I should change the focus to making the highly effective teachers more equitable for all kids.
Yes.
Versus, I don't know.
I love it. I love where you're coming. I understand you now. Okay. I wasn't following.
I was just thinking, yeah, instead of trying to promote them, maybe the ones that we have, making their tier one instruction more equitable.
Yeah. Well, and it really is like we have a legislative piece for asking to improve the quality of pre-K through three teachers, knowing that those have the most impact on the future pathway for children. And so investing dollars in the early years, but instead of investing it for random things, it really is about improving the quality of instruction so that kids can benefit from higher quality instruction. And that's where we're going as a state. Like until we improve what's happening, really other things, but that's really where you turn outcomes is making sure you have high quality teachers.
Do you think, though, so much funding, most, I would say the majority of funding for EL support comes from federal programs?
There's so little money coming from federal
programs. So my follow-up question is, you know, the fact that so many, I know that was a big
deal. Yeah. I get baited all the time.
With the fact that so many of us are struggling and trying to, has there been conversation about taking it to the Hill to get more funding?
So there is one initiative that's supposed to do like EL grants for schools that want to show that their practice works to kind of demonstrate proof of concept. So it's, I think it's $650,000 is the request. And so allowing LEAs to ask for some of that money to be able to change it and then using those as models to then say, we know what works now, let's.
But do you also know what works first?
I'm not sure how it's written. I'll check in with Christelle. I think I'm pretty sure it's out of hers. A lot of it is like if people will like if any of you've been to the Title III visits and like the elements we're asking people to do are the things that should work, like academic conversation, ensuring you're scaffolding for language, and the things that we're looking for matter. And so thinking about those structures, what parts in that could you use the money to help teachers be able to do, I guess might be one example, right? So we know that language opportunities, academic conversations matter. Let's help give our teachers professional learning so they see how to embed academic language. I think that's what they're for, is more like use the evidence base that we know, like it's don't create the wheel. Like, there's an evidence base for what works for English learners. And thank you. Keep in mind, like, we're not going to go way off base with evidence base, right? Like we're really as an agency trying to say, stop trying to create the wheel, everyone. Like, yes, we need innovation, but we also need to say, we know what works in a lot of settings, right? Let's go back to the research and the evidence and use that to leverage our practice. So I believe the grants are for taking what we know and implementing it in schools to show that that does change outcomes.
So I think that's where it is, to make sure we all know what that is, to make sure that I'll just recreating the wheel, but we're on a whole.
I'll make a note to chat with Christelle before December 4th, or maybe we can invite her to give you some insights on what that grant will look like. Because you might want to consider how could we use whatever we decide today to leverage ourselves to be set up well for that grant in this group, right? Like if there's money going to be coming, how do you kind of set yourself up for success? Given our EL data, I would hope that the state would support some money going. It's not a lot of money. I mean, you consider I'm asking for 39 million in pre-K 3. She's asking for 650,000. It's not a lot. So I'll make a note of it on our notes.
So what food am I missing? What food are you guys eating? It sounds good.
Skittles and M&M's virtual snacks. So sorry.
Gosh.
Next time.
I have one quick wonder on your previous slide. It doesn't state explicitly coaching. as a support, and I wonder if that's because not every district is equipped with a coaching model. And so until Daniel make that explicit.
So you get money for well, you guys are you're too big. You're too big for money for that. We are for early literacy or early learning, which will be math and reading, pre-K free. There'll be some dollars coming in for professional learning. The intent is you get $900 per teacher, which depending on your size of your LA may be a sizable amount, but you could use that money to invest in coaches because ultimately coaching is what's going to change practice. Just giving training isn't sufficient for changing practice. You need someone to come and support you in that change. And when you hit a barrier, to help you get past that barrier. The legislation always also requires that your administrator comes in and inspects what's been trained to see that it's happening in school. So you have the evaluative support, but the coaching support is going to be your lever.
We actually do that. We designed our model last year, this is the second year, where in K-3 we have instructional literacy coaches and instructional EL coaches in K-3 that work specifically.
That's awesome.
Use the K-3 grant in that way.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's only when we did that are we starting to get a handle on what's happening with EL and trying to do that, but it's still not enough.
They work simultaneously? Like, are they the same campus, like one campus?
Or they're different, and if we had more, the difficulty is our instructional literacy coaches is one coach per two schools.
Oh.
But because it's such limited funds with EL, they're carrying various schools because in some schools there's lots, in some schools there's little, there's, you know, and they work with paras and they help provide, you know.
We do the compliance aspects, the instructional coaching.
We
were able to break some funds, just a little bit of the at risk so that we can cover up the sixth grade as well with those specialists, just because of that equity. We needed to make sure that we covered across and were being fair to the school, but our responsibility, our main job description, well, that's very clear, and I have to address it over and over. We're instructional coaches. Our jobs are to change instructional practices. And so many times we'll find that we get caught up into, oh, we're going to start seeing some kids. I have to pull that back and work with.
It's not a pull-out method. It's improving our teacher practice so that it's a greater effective.
I'm really interested in seeing all that data to see how we did our first year. Because I work with the literacy departments that we could work together on areas, gaps that were in. And so we're still making a lot of changes in progress, but it's been so exciting. That's why I said elementary is going better, because last year
we had those additional support.
What our additional funding.
And the principals are starting to back up EL practices based on that integrity, professional development, literacy with the development they're doing and how they tie it. And we're starting to get those mixed conversations that were very productive. And so those are those moments where you're like, okay, secondary, I love you, but elementary, this is so cool to see.
I'm going to move on. Is it possible to move on?
Yeah, actually, it's definitely possible. Do you mind if we take a 10-minute walkabout break? They've been in meetings all day.
Oh, no, that's no problem.
Okay. Yeah. Let's do a 10 minutes, 2:52. We'll be back and at it. But I want to give you a mental walkabout break, too.
Thanks,
Jeff. We'll be back.
Okay.
Yeah. So I have the email traffic.
State, what's working?
Does it make it like weight or
Okay. No worries. Thanks for looking into it.
Don't cover anything that's important.
At least email me.
Okay. Well, I'll give you the notes in our next PLC. How's that?
I'm always on your list.
Educator effectiveness, that's right.
Oh, yes,
I need that's on vacation and learning. Okay.
Awesome.
So, you like that?
I do. Yeah. It's so different than, you know, teaching, regardless whether you're at the university.
Yes. And now you're stretching. So they all stay versus.
I know.
One location. I'm just finishing up my last two chapters. So I'm just in the process. Actually, I have to submit my first full draft the first week of January. Yeah, so I'm just writing chapter 4, 5, and 6. Basically,
you're up all
night,
aren't you?
To say the least, the next, what is it, 9 weeks? I'm gonna be filled by work.
Yes,
I think if I get to the first week of January, going with at least a year draft.
Most of future meetings, I won't be here the whole time. It will be you, just so you know. It's because Jeff I hired like a week ago, so I felt like I needed a little more
contact.
Where the other ones I've been working with. Just know it's all on me. Note taking.
And I look at Jennifer and I'm like, well, there is a line at the end of the tunnel. Amazing experience, only because I never thought I would do science. But sort of, you know, different experiences and just took me that route. And
it looks like you're trying to
sell something. I chose that.
Why'd you yawn? Why'd you yawn?
Otherwise, I wouldn't.
Here's a lot of stuff.
Oh, cool. How many people are you?
Great, thank you. Yeah, there were a lot of
I have to finish. I have to finish first. But
oh, Jeff, are you there?
I have a different respect for people that have been through that process. Now that I really understand that it's not
He's giving you the wall now.
Yeah.
So, he's like, oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
I decided this is the bee hive because of the bees.
Those are box elder bugs.
Oh, are they?
And the
wasp. So like last year, I was watching one and I said, "What are they doing with the bees?" They're all over the place.
There's so many of them.
One would go on me, so I.
Yeah, they're everywhere.
We'll
like,
they don't tag along.
Just look over
they
there.
Don't bite. So, they don't do anything.
Well, look
ugly.
Over there in the drawer. You'll see them.
They're
yeah, you can see them on the door.
Yeah, box elder bugs, they just swarm like trees and stuff. Like they'll completely cover them.
But is it just this
one? So far. Well, like, oh, wait, check the other. I'm sure they'll be moving out soon.
So far.
Thank you so much for this experience.
Yeah.
Were you trying to create a seed experience for us? Or are you going to start investigating?
We bring the bugs in. She brought them with her.
Let's bring it.
This is
my phenomenon. Yeah. We already know there's no seal.
Check in the phone. You guys okay?
So far, so good, other than when you came on in your pocket or something.
We heard a few things.
You were coughing. We had a moment. It's fine.
Like, who's doing that? Who's doing that? I'm like,
it's Jerry. She muted you. We were fine. Something happened in the pocket. Trisha.
He's thinking back to what he was doing.
I don't
He's
know.
Like, where was I? What was I doing?
What was I putting next to that was popping? Thanks, Jer. I'm sure he'll be here. Too funny. Jeff. Christelle told me to tell you hello. I don't know if you know our Christelle, but she knows you.
Yeah, tell her hello back when she gets a chance.
She emailed me this morning. She's like, I heard you're running an EL group. What are you doing and who's running it? And I said, Jeff. She's like, oh, okay. So your name calmed her down. So thank you.
That's good. As long as I'm on time, right?
Right. Hey, we survived. I'm like, I can do intros. I was hoping by the time we got to the part we did, you were here. So it worked out perfectly.
Okay, good. Yeah, I apologize.
Oh no, here's a spider. Okay,
nope. I forget. I thought the time change. Like, I bet he thinks it's one hit time. I'm sorry. We'll be more clear on that.
Okay. No. Well, now I know. And next. Stephen will be there next time.
Oh yes.
And I'm gonna come the other two times.
Okay, perfect.
So there shouldn't be a problem. My watch will automatically tell me what time it is when I'm there.
That is true.
My phone.
So he's coming here for
some of them. So yeah, they'll be for all the other ones. They'll be coming. So it's him and Stephen, they're partners in the work, and so Stephen will come next month or in December. And then Jeff will be here for the final two.
Same time.
1 to 4 in USBE basement.
We'll be in breakout rooms at USBE. So we'll be in like room 156, okay. But we'll be at the USBE in the future meetings. But
excellent.
Yeah. So Jeff, they will be face to face. It's just, I asked him last week. So
he just wanted to check.
He didn't
want to
fly
in.
And
well,
I almost
could have, let's say, but I flew in last night and I'm leaving tomorrow.
Where is he from? Where are you from?
I'm in San Francisco area.
Palo Alto.
Yeah. I'm actually live in Redwood City, so that's where I am now. But and then I just got back from Kentucky last night and I'm going to Buffalo tomorrow. So it's just would have been a little bit too tight.
How's Kentucky been?
But the M&Ms sound really good. it was great. Yeah, it was a two-day training of mostly teachers. And there was some workshop time where they could sit down and enhance their activities, you know, and like take time and say, oh, yeah, I do Socratic seminar. How can I make that better? Even just class discussion, whole class discussion can be more authentic. You know, so there's a lot of stuff that they kind of got their hands dirty and I thought made a lot of progress. And then, yeah, they appreciated it.
That's so nice they gave that opportunity. Sometimes we just give so much content.
Yeah, it was a nice, And there were some principals there, I think, principals and coaches, which helped. Yeah, it was fun. It was a good group. I'm looking forward to going back there at some point. So
nice.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to get started because this is the room. So we are 2:53. I'm an on-time person. You will learn this about me. I did not like not starting on time today. So let's continue on with the agenda. Jeff, lead on.
So some of you, you know, have, and this is going to be a little more, I'll just introduce it, and then I want you to work individually and then in pairs on this. It's a draft improvement plan. So it's not something I'm forcing upon you. I just want to show you a sample of what we could be doing. You don't have to do this, and you might already have something like it. I don't know. But it starts with looking at what differences, what student evidence do we want to see? Right. So some people, you know, well, they'll slap test scores in there. That's fine. But really, you know, in terms of language, in terms of whatever you want, I mean, whatever our problem is, the challenges, the biggest challenges. So this would be also a place to put, you know, overcome the challenge of this, and then this would be the evidence. So just, you know, what do we want to happen? And I put the word significant in there because it means that, you know, I really want to see a change in what's currently happening. It's not just on maturation. It's not just I want to see growth that comes from whatever we're already doing. But, you know, what would be the significant differences in whatever? It could be language, content. It could be attendance, whatever, you know, you're looking for that you think you want to see improve, right? You could have some tools down there that would actually show this evidence. Like, for example, I have a tool that I often use called the conversation, observation, and analysis tool. And it's something that, you know, both administrators and teachers can use just to observe students' conversations and to decide, oh yeah, this is a good conversation. This needs some work. And here are the spots that it needs work in. So that's just an example, right? Then there's what's going to happen in the classroom to cause those differences to happen. So this is, you know, this is like backward planning, right? We're all familiar with all forms of backward planning. But I just wanted to zoom in on what are the student differences and then what happens in the classroom that, and again, and I could put the word significant there too, but what are the interventions? What new things are we going to do? What changes are we going to make to make those differences in students happen? You know, for example, we're gonna work on in the classroom. You're gonna see more authentic communication happening, let's say, or more oral language, or you know, increased quality and quantity of student conversations, or pair share, better pair shares, or better reading. You know, better whatever the reading intervention might be, and in terms of more idea building, more explicit every day, teachers focusing on, oh, this is the idea we're building today, and this is, and here's some activities we're going to do it, right? That seeing that idea building mindset, that idea building culture happening in the classroom. That's just, you know, again, that's just classroom. And then down below, of course, is the systems, the leadership, and the PD that support. Often you'll see, you know, you'll see it more on the classroom side, but there are things that we do, and some of you have already mentioned it, you know, scheduling or placement of, you know, certain teachers, effective teachers and access and that kind of thing, that can also make a difference in that student elements. That's why that arrow on the right is there, right? Because you're not always going through the classroom. There might be other things you do, you know, that make a difference. Now, on both of those boxes, I just mentioned what, you know, it has evidence. So what's the classroom evidence? If I were to go into, and I'll do this for now, but if I were to go back into the classroom, do I have some tools like, you know, instructional rounds tools? And am I looking for the things that the differences in the classroom based on that tool and based on that process of looking and taking notes in the classroom? So this is more like, you know, intermediate evidence because it's classroom based evidence. And then the student evidence would be, you know, actual what the students are showing in terms of their learning. And then finally, again, what's the evidence at the system level? Well, the evidence is we changed our schedule. That would be a pretty, you know, clear piece of evidence. Or the evidence is we decided to hire a coach and have coaches get highly involved in what's going on in the professional development trainings, and then bring them out to the, you know, do something extra around the coaching. Or we decided the coaches would go in and model activities that were conversation-based or oral language, and follow up on those, you know, in this kind of way. So I think that kind of, you know, makes enough sense. Any questions right now on what you're going to do? Because I'm going to have you essentially draw these boxes and start to kind of brainstorm some ideas that might go in there. If that's okay. Is that okay, Jennifer? Uh-huh. Okay. Any questions right now? So we've already had a lot of stuff kind of, you know, that we've been talking about, and a lot of it fits into here. So that's why this is a way to gather, okay, now I want to see some direct connections between all these things. Oftentimes, as we all know, you can't just have the top two boxes because things don't last and they're not supported well enough, right? And especially without the coaching, without the PD, without the leadership support. Because if a leader says, no, I just want test scores, I don't care about all this oral language stuff, then you're going to have, you know, a lot more challenges. So, and I know that's all, you know, pretty obvious, but so any questions before I let you loose for a few minutes? No? Okay. So feel free to do it individually. And if you want to, you know, bounce some ideas off someone else next to you, that's fine afterwards. But really, I'd like to just kind of get you started, because your district is unique, at least right now. And then you might have some commonalities with some other districts that we can share in a minute. And ideally, at the end, we would come to, kind of like Jennifer said, maybe some, you know, some consensus on some things. It doesn't have to be complete consensus on one thing, but just some buckets or some less amorphous focuses that we might get excited about. Does that sound all right? Okay, so just take a few minutes. Doesn't have to be silent, but again, you know, start off at least individually, put a few things down. All right, ready, go.
Thank you.
against each other.
Jennifer, do you mind going around and checking on the progress?
Sure.
Well, I'm like, were we off task?
So that's what we do.
And I wonder if your number.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to stop you there. Hello? Hello? Ding, ding, ding. Hello. Hello. Hello.
I can't believe you. This is
Jennifer.
Oh, that's funny.
Hello.
He's trying to stop us.
Oh, John.
Yeah.
Bring it on back, my friend.
Yeah, sorry. I almost started singing, so. All right. What I'd like you to do now. Hello? Hello? Hello, hello, hello. Hi.
Okay. Thank you. All right.
All right.
We're almost ready. They're almost quiet.
Well,
there were some good intentional conversations, Jeff, as I walked around.
Good.
That's why you're having a hard time pulling them back.
No, I know. That's good. That's a good sign. I hesitate to do this. And what I want you to do now is actually go back to your papers. You can talk a little bit, but try to come back a little sooner this next time. I want you to pray.
That's called feedback, everyone.
No, I wasn't sure if I was on mute or not, and I didn't think I was, but anyway.
Oh, you might have been on and off.
I thought someone was there pushing the mute button on me, and so anyway.
Melissa's taking the blame over there.
Wouldn't be the first time. But what I want you to do now is look at each of the boxes. Hopefully you got at least, you know, one or two things, ideally two things, in each box, and prioritize what you think are the highest need and also highest leverage, right? So highest need would probably be in the, student box. But then in the classroom box, what would be, you know, the highest need and highest leverage? Because there might be a need, but you might not think it's that powerful, or vice versa. So what do you think teachers, you know, in classrooms need, and how do you think it's going to be the most powerful for bringing about the evidence in the right-hand box, in the student box? And also the same with the lower box. So you can just put numbers on there. Just take it. I'll give you, just a couple minutes to think about those priorities. And then we're going to share your top priorities in the group. Okay? So ready? Go.
Ready, go. Jeff, they need reteaching.
I don't think I taught.
You're welcome.
This is called being an English learner. We need it again.
We need
a little repetition. tactician with some hand gestures.
Well, I don't know if I really did much teaching.
Okay, voice is off because we can't hear him without your
voice. I don't think I did much teaching, so there won't be much reteaching, but I will try to clarify.
Okay.
So what I want you to do is you guys filled in some things in those three boxes, right? Uh-huh. Student box, classroom box, and leadership or system box. Prioritize what you think what you want to work on the most. So put a 1, a 2, and a 3 next to some of those things in each box. So each box should have a number 1, and if there's multiple, you know, a 1, a 2, or a 3 that you really want to work on. So we're trying to zoom in. Some of you might have 5 things in the student box, but we don't have the, you know, we're not going to work on 5 different things. So we're really trying to narrow down, you know, to 1 or 2 things in each box. And then we're going to try to decide as a group, you know, what are the things that we're going to focus on in this learning community. All right. Is that clearer?
So whatever comes out of this conversation is going to drive what we're going to do with this group. So if that doesn't match what you started writing down, reassess yourself. You're gonna get the PowerPoint. I'm gonna ask him for the PowerPoint. Jeff, are you okay to share the PowerPoint? Okay.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Okay. He got this a week ago, so he's probably just finished those.
Yes.
So, for example, here's what Cash would have asked for. 1, because I asked them, I'm like, "What are your things?" Because they had to drive home. She had a conflict, but teachers, like, how do we help our teachers help themselves to help these students? 2, what are the systems and structures we need at the district level to be able to provide supports? Like, what are those behaviors? So for example, where I was, we would group students in schools that had like 4 or 5 per grade level in the same teacher's classroom, because having 1 or 2 didn't give enough cause for the teacher to change their practice. But you throw in 4 or 5, whether that's gifted kids or ESL kids, and the teachers are more willing. So that was a structure thing we did at the district level, that instead of just letting them go wherever, we put all, not all, like if there's more than 5, then we split them up, because it's just too many. You don't want to isolate the ELs, but it was nice for the teacher to have a critical mass to be thoughtful of in their instruction. Mm-hmm. So that was like a structure thing that we did at the district level. And then 3, theirs was around training. I can't remember the 3rd. It'll come back. Those are 2 examples of like what they would like to see this group attack, is like, what do we do for teachers? What might be the avenue there? And what do we do in the system to change our supports to create the conditions for these kids to be successful?
But I would even get more specific, like the conditions, what would be a condition? And that would be a classroom, probably that would go in the classroom box. And then what more specifically would be for what you want to see in students, right? So getting, drilling down a little bit more, not, you know, not down to I want them to use commas correctly, but just something a little more. Okay, so go ahead and give a couple minutes to prioritize those.
Okay, does that help set the stage? Okay, they're ready now, they're working.
You could prioritize using those numbers, and you can mention however many you want.
Yeah, I would say throw out what you want, because we're going to come together as a group to prioritize. So don't hold back. We'll see what the commonality is like first and use that as prioritization. Yeah.
So, you know, so much is because entry point where they score on the WIDA and accessing grade level materials with expectations like successful.
And in between that is the staff. So then, once we have that,
Knowing that as a teacher is
They must be special ed. So if they can't read, what can you do to help them with that? Because listening vocabulary is usually more advanced than that reading vocabulary. And so how do we support them? Why we teach them to read, which is still required, but we have to give them access to grade level content material, otherwise they just fall farther and farther behind. Like if you don't get the content, the vocabulary, the background knowledge that's built in your grade level, it's really hard to close that gap over time. And so it's not holding the kids back, but it's thinking, what do I do differently to make sure they can access it? Right? Does that help? Yeah, I mean, because they're really thinking grade level standards.
Absolutely.
But for now, it's going to take staff, especially if they're a newcomer or grade.
I'm not going to lie. We're
still going to have those expectations trying to get there. But my goal is to develop their skills so they get closer to getting there. Over a few years, we might get there. But
they come in with no language.
And that's fine. I would let them say, like, you have to pass. Okay, what does that look like to get back here? It can't just be, let me put the passages. With support, you can answer them. I can independently read a textbook and help them understand. In the meantime, until I get to that point, teacher is the entry point in the comprehension. They're going to give me staff reading. I can't not read that textbook, but how am I going to read?
Because the 5 to 7 years is a mean taste about long for them to access the content, but it means that comparable to a language is going to take from that and to be comparable, right? But in the meantime, they're able to access the content with the high school.
So if we started kidding kindergarten, finally they don't imagine they should be like their shoes, right? Yep. Like they should be in front of a whole bunch of girls. It's been the long-term yield in middle school and they still haven't gotten there. We failed them. Now when they come in as eighth grade, you're like, okay, we got to ramp up.
That makes sense,
right? Yeah. Just,
so what are they? What are they?
Do you think that's enough time?
Yeah, I think they're ready. There's one group that's still working intensely, but I think they'll be okay to.
Do you want to take notes?
Yep, I will take the notes. I'm ready. Let's pull you back in 10 seconds.
Sorry to cut you off. I know you're
back in three.
We're good to go.
Two, one. We count together, Jeff. Zero.
Zero. All right.
He's counting with me. It's adorable. Negative half.
Now.
So
what I think what you know, there's not a lot of time left. So what I wanted to do was just try to come to some negotiation or some agreement on, you know, one or two is best on focuses for this group. Now, ideally there would be a focus across K-12, right? And wherever we are, but if not, if we wanted to separate them, that's fine. But let's just hear right now some of the priorities and pretty quickly, right? We don't need a lot of elaboration, but pretty quickly, what are the priorities starting with student box, then classroom, and then systems or leadership? Let's go around and share real quick what they are.
Start with Twilla.
So looking at your templates, I'm going to start at the instructional and curricular interventions block.
Okay.
Sort of did this in a thing, yeah. So we have two. One of them, I'm going to go through one first and then two because we're going to go through class. So one is a newcomer class for the first year and for first year newcomers. What we would want to see is significant differences. We want to see VITA data, participation data, language use frequency data, and data from core classes. That we would need in place would be curriculum and training and coaching. Now that circle would then lead into our second circle, which would be from year two on, so coming out of that newcomer class, would be language development in all content areas. And that we would want to see the same types of evidences, but we would want to see an increase. And then the systems that we would need would be ongoing PD coaching. We talked about e-workshops using some of what WIDA has available. Mm-hmm. But we would think it would be K-12, although if we as a group wanted to focus just in secondary, we would totally the same.
Okay, great.
Our major focus that we're really trying to attain based on ESSA law and the state regulations at this point is letting go of what traditionally has been frequently used as EL or ESL classes for levels 1 through 4. And what we're trying to say is teachers, content teachers, need to understand that the law states that they're responsible for that support and instructional practices. Mm-hmm. And with that in mind, just getting rid of both classes has been very difficult, but that's created a pathway for us to say, those newcomers, which is in the regulation, it is an ESSA law, it's also with the Department of Justice and Office of Civil Rights. We can have separate classes for them, but you really can only justify that first year.
Yeah.
After that, all our students are going to be receiving that support within all core curriculum classes, and we treat that as equitable, but providing the coaching, providing the training, and anyway, so it's really exciting to see that shift.
Oh, love it. That's nice that you're, yeah, they're all responsible.
So to dig deeper into that, just so I guess I'm going against my elaboration rule, but I think what do those classrooms look like? Because it's exciting stuff you're talking about. Again, getting the language development out into the content class.
That's what we need for that support. The EL, you mean the newcomer classes?
No, I'm talking all the content classrooms, because you've got probably more than several teachers who have been teaching a certain way for years.
So there's a couple models right now that I'm looking into, and I'll be utilizing the district's departments to help. But one area of research right now would be the co-teaching model, where within that's part of the coaching, but the EL specialist per se for that school or schools would go in and co-teach with the content area teacher, because the content area teachers are the ones that are certified to teach the subject. And so, but within that, you need to be able to have additional supports that are going to lift that the everything that we're trying to do to accomplish. So the co-teaching model would be one aspect of that. EL shadowing with the specialists, where they go in and provide the team with information on how the students are being influenced and best practices for that. So those are questions that even in here would be really helpful to say this is how that's going to be best utilized.
Or even the instructional design. When we're looking at developing lesson plans, are we looking at scaffolding language? Are we looking at prior knowledge? Are we looking at the fact that are we just preaching to our kids, or are we having them experience it and making meaning for themselves? Are we using visual aids? Those types of things.
Right.
Which
that would also be in the classroom.
Is a big switch for many of our teachers, especially at the second grade.
Yeah. Okay, great. Who else? Priorities.
Similar.
Let's do it. Alpine.
Well, we have two.
We can do two Alpine. Alpine one.
Alpine one and Alpine two.
We really should be two districts.
Or three.
Trust me. Once you guys told us about your coaches and we realized what our job and how we got paid, we realized that
Do you want to come work for us?
I have 21 schools. She has 30 schools. She has 30 schools.
32.
We're still
Did you
job.
Hear that?
I'll talk to you later.
Chris is very good at stealing people.
How many schools do you have?
Where are these?
Each of 2020 something. Oh, building three more. Oh, wow.
Yeah. All right, focus, people, focus. Back together.
Back to all point. Thank you.
So, okay, I'm going to start and then you have to. Okay. So, we'll go in the same, but in the classroom, that tier one instruction that has high level support for L's across all content, K through 12, would be what our classroom would look like. And in our evidence and what it might, how we might do that is, well, originally we wrote deeper learning and then leveraging highly effective, like tier one EL supports with mainstream content teachers. But I think after we looked at it, we realized how important it is to integrate two of those and teach the deeper learning with leveraging the high level supports and using what teachers already do with the high level supports. And then the way to do that, we thought, but would be through PD, but we just had a district-wide PD on Monday. So making sure that we are an active participant, and it hasn't been historically, we haven't been super, we haven't been joined in those conversations at the district level as a department, and just being able to have a place there. And I mean, I'm just going to say this frankly, but being able to be in my position and not just talk to ELD teachers, but on Monday I got to talk to 150 secondary English teachers, which was number one intimidating, but two, like, I got time with those people, and that's the ones that keep talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so consistently making that a thing, and that's how we're going to leverage those high level of supports with the deeper learning. And so that day was just about how deeper learning can be used in diverse manners. And that
so,
deeper learning
is doing. If you could clarify briefly, let's say I don't know a whole lot about deeper learning. I know some, but I don't. Let's say I don't know much. What would I look for? Maybe I'm tasked with going into a classroom. What am I looking for that's different from what is the norm? So see, we're trying to get at, I don't want a teacher to say, oh yeah, I'm already doing that. Mm-hmm. I don't want every single teacher to say, I'm already doing this. I guess I'm doing deeper learning. What I would like is to be able to, you know, explain to the teacher or explain to me, the observer, okay, this is what we're looking for that is a evidence of deeper learning, or this is what deeper learning looks like in a classroom that isn't really happening widespread right now.
So to me, that looks like the students are active participants, and maybe that vocabulary or those strategies that we're using, maybe they're using those in a collaborative way, that we've modeled that so that they're now doing it with each other, or they're now teaching that, or they're asking the vocabulary, how do I say this? And then we give them a sentence frame, which would be the highly effective support, and then they take that sentence frame and use it in this academic context. And so there's more of a critical thinking or solving this big problem or at a bigger scale or a global scale, and or figuring out what was the disservice in this situation or those types of things versus a traditional looking setting, even with diverse learners. Not everyone's looking the same, but everyone's an active participant.
It's creating
it's a little bit
quality dialogue too, right?
Yeah. So it's a little bit like what I said in the beginning about you're building up key ideas using the academic language, vocabulary and grammar, whatever, but you're building towards something and you're using it meaningfully. So that's what I would want to, you know, that's what I would look for in that spot, right? And then of course you might have student evidence would be they're saying more than they normally say. And they're really pushing themselves to use academic vocabulary or pushing themselves to clarify, pushing each other to support their ideas. Because normally, you know, when I see a lot of classrooms and kids do not, you know, whether it's a pair share, a conversation, a classroom, they don't want to ask each other for support. They don't want to ask each other to clarify. Why? Because they don't care. right? Because it would be extra work for me to listen, and I don't want to make you work extra hard to talk again. And so I'm just kind of getting into the, you know, nitty gritty of what that looks like. And I think it's a great focus in terms of, you know, as long as we're kind of specific about it, as long as teachers know that it's not what you're already doing, right? This is different. And I want a teacher to think, oh, this is different and it makes sense. I'm going to try it. It's not, this is different and I'm not going to do it because it's just a fad, right? We want them to kind of get hooked in. And that's another part of this work that's not easy, because it's the, you know, the messaging and the buy-in, as you all know very well, right? So sorry, I'll let you keep going. I know there's other people to share, but.
That's where we immediately went, maybe not that specific, but we automatically went to instructional conversations or academic conversations as the instructional and curricular sort of intervention. And then thinking about the evidence of that is not only sort of like the success criteria for me as a teacher, but also how do students know that they are effectively engaging in that academic conversation? So articulating that very explicitly, for example, I am looking at my partner, I am listening actively, I am taking turns, I am using the tools that I was provided with the sentence frame, for example, if we're engaging in an argument, I agree because, or I disagree because, or sort of, that will be the evidence I will be looking for as a teacher if I am using that as my high leverage instructional practice. And then the difference in students will be listening to them using that language effectively with one another. And again, the tool will allow me to listen for those specific things, because that's the scaffold that they are using. And in thinking in terms of the systems leadership or PD, hopefully before teachers start enacting that practice, I have provided some professional development that shows them what that feel like, what that look like, help and role play a little bit with one another. Mm-hmm. And in thinking about systems, what are those opportunities throughout the year that are reinforced through coaching, through time for additional professional learning opportunities? And also with the leadership, I brought the thought of, you know, what if you have a principal that thinks that productive noise is something really terrible and that you don't have any classroom management, then that will really not be a supportive or conducive environment for you to even take risk in practicing this new skill with your students. So sort of thinking in that way. And then what's my evidence after I provided that PD, working along with coaches and seeing some of those practices in action?
Right. Great. Anybody else?
We've got Park City and North Summit. Russ or Martin?
So, listen, you guys are all framing the house. I'm trying to put forward the foundation.
I'm going to
start with the student evidence. We're being judged on the media. We is pretty much a mystery.
It's him, so.
It's not an issue. We're very nimble. That's a nice thing about it. We can move on fine. But I just got to have it simple. I got to have, it's got to line up. And I hope that doesn't come across that I'm like, no. I don't care about school.
I don't care about school. There's not a right or wrong.
You know, I don't really care about the kid. I just care about school. No, I think that's going to help.
The score is the.
But ultimately, I think that's why we're all here.
We're being judged on this.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Thank you. Online?
I'm thinking simply. I'm looking at the foundation. My goal is I want to be able to look at this idea of the instructional intervention. And I want to be able to embed in the science needs that I provide for the science leaders all over the state three or four things within the PD that I can model. That I can say these things will help support language acquisition during science instruction. So I guess that sounds really simple, but that's really what I want. What are three or four things I can put in the PD model for science leaders that they can then model for teachers that could be used in the class to help students communicate in science?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Can I go
on
your
own? Yeah.
I kind of go back to what you and Sarah did for our little elementary school start reading. You came in, you looked at our stuff, said, yeah, try this. You know, and it works.
Your work there is done.
You know, very simple.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I think thinking about the end in mind, the goal is that students are capable to pass whatever assessment they're given. The WIDA helps you to know where their current language levels are so you know what to move to next, right? So if my kids can do these, what do I have to do to support them in getting to this level? So it's helping teachers to see that transition. Here's their current abilities, and then what. Here's where we want them to be, right? Because they need to go from a 2 to a 3 or a 3 to 4. Our goal is at least one level, maybe it's more, but at least one level each year, right? That they're slowly moving up that trajectory to being in monitoring status and released from the English learner world. But teachers have to know what those can-dos are so that they can then adjust their instruction to say, okay, they can already do this. So I'm not going to ask yes-no questions, right? Like as a level one, yes-no questions is might where I start. Now I'm going to ask more elaborative questions, not super detailed, but further along the trajectory until I can get to multiple sentences, right? That they can articulate their ideas. And so I think from what I'm hearing so far, and I want to finish, but it sounds like some highly effective practices that we can leverage to help improve practice in the classroom for English learners and all students, with consideration as what is the measure we're going to be kind of measured by to see how well we're doing this. If we could come up with those best practices and see how they connect with the WIDA to help teachers see if you do these things, language levels will improve. But the easiest, simplest thing is kids need to talk more. You can't improve language levels if they don't talk.
2-1. 2-1.
Yes. And it can't be the ESL classroom. Which, nor some, you probably don't even have an ESL classroom. Do you guys pull them out? I didn't think so. And so in a lot of settings, they're not getting pulled out. The teacher is the English language instruction, which honestly, you don't need pull out if the teacher does it well, right? We do pull out to make sure something happens with those children. But ultimately, we need to engage in more academic conversation, more reading and writing tasks that are scaffolded so kids have access. It's the simplest thing. And it's identifying what are those practices that you think, I always like to try to do like the easiest wins so that there's a quick return on their investment. So they'll buy into the things that might be a little harder, right? Like adding language frames to your day is not super hard, but it gives them the grammatical structures, it gives them the language supports to be able to articulate their ideas in an academic way that then translates to writing over time. And so thinking about what would be those leverage supports, and I think that's where Jeff will be really helpful, that we could put into the system while also considering what do we know about the assessment. Go ahead, Jeff.
So are people, I think that's a great synthesis. So are people okay with, let's say for now, and I didn't hear everybody that well, but putting the quantity and in the classroom box, increase the quantity and quality of classroom talk across disciplines, like something like that across content areas. So, and that's including, pair share, which would be speaking, listening, but also conversations would be like in parentheses. Is that something that, I'm just trying to, I don't want to I don't want to put words in your mouth, but.
Let me have the online people, if they have anything, feel free to turn your mics on and ad lib if that's not going to align with yours. And Martin, you haven't had a chance, but with what Jeff's kind of summarizing, if we focus on increasing the quality and quantity of classroom academic discussion across the content areas, would that align with what you're thinking, or is it outside of what you're thinking?
And I think just one thing to add to that, to keep in mind as we do it, is that ever-present immersion instructional model in there, how we can do what's best for our kids.
Are you thinking about the ESL kids in those classes? Okay.
So that will be sort of like an additional context, right? So we have the content areas inclusive of DLI.
Yeah, and then, it's just too many schools have thought, oh, they're in Spanish dual immersion, so they'll get all that they need in Spanish. I say,
they don't.
Yeah,
100%. Yeah, but what's happening in English time? Okay. Jeff, one more comment here in the moment.
I just wanted to mention, I think there needs to be a space too for educating educators on just the fundamentals. What is the LEDA? What are CANDOs? There's a lot of acronyms, there's a lot of vocabulary that if you're not savvy, it can be really confusing. And you're shaking your head, yes, because I think it's great, deeper learning and these. Those are all such important things, but if educators aren't aware of that fundamental foundation of what it means to progress an ELL child, I think it's going to be hard to help them progress up the ladder in any other way.
All right, Jeff, your turn.
I don't know what I was going to say, but
Very important.
Well, I think one of the things that we can do in that, also in that box, the classroom box, is, you know, in addition to increasing the, and I would say classroom talk, because it doesn't have to be discussion per se, but increasing the quantity and quality of classroom talk, and that in parentheses, maybe if people are okay with this, in parentheses, listening, speaking, and conversation. And then below that is, you know, giving appropriate supports and scaffolds, which would include sentence frames, vocabulary, that kind of thing. And then even below that, two more things. One is, you know, not forgetting the power of building up ideas and bridging information gaps. Because I think those two things are going to strengthen the quality and even the quantity of classroom talk. If people are just doing it for points, it's bare minimum time, right? And the final thing would be, I think came up at the end, I didn't hear very well, but is to actually try out some enhanced strategies that do this. So, you know, on a concrete level, because that's not all that concrete, quantity and quality, but then try out an enhanced pair share or academic conversation supports, or a graphic organizer that supports argumentation in a conversation, right? So just trying out a couple things that actually do that would be a more concrete level, like you guys were saying, I think. And then on the other box that it feeds into, there's plenty, right? You could say increased reading, increased writing, increased oral language, increased, there's quite a few things that talk might produce, right? And I would want it to be beyond the normal, beyond like significant, right? Not something that just comes from 1 year of maturation or 1 year of being in U.S. schools. That's not quite enough for a lot of kids. What we do in the classroom makes a significant difference. And then below it, it's more in your, you guys know your systems and leadership much better than I do. But below it, like many of you have already said, you have coaching and PLCs, those kind of things, focus on this particular topic, if possible. I know there's an element of choice in there, but I don't know very many teachers who are really into teaching that think that kids should talk less in their class about content, right? Most of them are pretty like...
Talking is an easier entry point for your content teachers than forcing reading and writing.
Yeah.
Now, but in addition to that, some of these strategies for some content teachers, writing is an attractive thing. Because if you say, if you have a conversation before writing and it improves their writing, some of the teachers say, okay, I'll try it now. So we have to leverage that as well, right? Because in some cases, some teachers are like, I don't know, I don't want to be that loud. You know, it's a little bit crazy. But if you say, well, try this out a couple times and see how the writing differs. And if you're not sold, and this is, I often say this, if you're not sold after trying this a few times, then go back to your old ways. But like I have one strategy that I tend to train in, and it's called the stronger and clearer each time. And it's essentially three pair shares in a row, but there's a pre and a post write involved. And so every time a teacher does this, if the kid is actually trying, there's a huge difference between the pre and the post write because the kid has talked about it three times with three different partners in between the two writings. So, I mean, that's just an example of kind of it's an activity that it's an easily doable activity that could fit in that classroom box as well. In addition to, let's say, improved pair shares or, like I said, graphic organizers for conversations. So I'm just kind of throwing this out there as things that could be practical things that we do before December, right? When you bring back some of this information or evidence in December. And you guys have a lot more in the lower box there, I think, that you could add as homework. Should I say speaking of homework?
Speaking of homework.
Yeah. So speaking of homework, there were a few other slides that I'll still keep included, but a lot of them have to do with focusing in on what we're going to focus on in this group. And ideally, we would get started on it, right? So ideally we would say, okay, well, how are we gonna bring about some of this, you know, some more talk in classrooms, let's say, if this is, you know, if you wanna focus on this. And, you know, what are you gonna do with your 21 schools or whatever, however many schools you have, especially if maybe you don't have a PD day in between, you know, how do you like get some coaches together or even just start a pilot kind of pilot plan. Maybe you work with one school or two schools and you have some go-getter teachers that say, oh yeah, I'd like to do this. Let me think about, let's get together. Let's look at, you know, what we can do and do some of this, you know, increasing of talk in the classroom and see what happens. So the homework would be, you know, try some of this out. Even if you don't get a chance to try some of this out, maybe you try to gather some evidence of classroom talk that we can actually, you know, listen to and look at by December 4th.
And so, one simple way, and maybe you have a way to for them to collect that. One simple way is just how much time is teacher? Like you just time it, and then how much time are students? And just seeing the opportunity. Yeah. And it's not one student talking. That's insufficient. Like the vast majority of kids having an opportunity to engage. That's where the partner talk is more powerful than when we choose one kid at a time. Because you don't get the minutes, you don't get the oral practice that needs to occur.
Yeah, that's, you could take notes.
You'd be that. Shocked. Follow a kid around for a day. Much academic homework to engage in. Yeah. Follow an EL in your system. You'll be saddened by the amount of language they practice on a daily basis. Yeah, and we allow it because they're like, oh, they're ELs.
Now another thing I would look at in addition. I mean, if you're in a classroom. In fact, that would be part of the homework. Would, you know, try to get into at least one or two classrooms. Look for the authenticity of the communication too. You know, our kids, you know, can you kind of tell if they're just doing it for points or if they're really trying to inform others of their ideas? Look for the building up of an idea. Is this activity helping them build up something that's either a concept or a claim in the discipline? And if not, are they doing it just to cover some standard for points on a test, right? Even though that's been the mode for a long time, I understand, but it shouldn't be happening all period long, all day long for these kids.
All right. And given we have 4 minutes and unfortunately I have a meeting back at the office at 4:15, what I'd like to do is wrap up with where to go next in our agenda based on our norms and establishing where we'll head next. So given we kind of have three big ideas, we didn't hit everything. We didn't come up with the newcomer approach at this time. But focusing on that universal intention around increasing the quality and quantity of classroom talk while providing the necessary supports across the content areas, including DLI students, and using those strategies to enhance instruction and figuring out what those strategies are. And then what does the PL opportunity look like? So from a state person, I'm like, okay, how do we do it? What are the strategies? Let's build some PL materials to help you all do that. Could be one way to do this. But that's because that's how I work at a state level, right? What does this look like for you in our next meeting? What is the next logical step for how we achieve that universal intention?
I would like, so I've been trying to build the little template on my page based on what he said. If we could have a completed one to be able to work from, I think a great place right now, I don't know about you, but my brain is fried.
Mm-hmm.
So I would love to start with the template again.
Using our big idea.
Based on this, now let's talk about how that would manifest at each of our locations. And I think along with what Jeff is saying, let's determine a collection tool of how to gauge where we are currently. We know it's going to be different in different locations, and then how we may be able to monitor the impact once we develop these strategies to determine if it was an effective
one. I love it.
If we can hone that together, and it gives us some time to really absorb everything that we talked about.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's great.
Anything to add to Trisha's proposal? And I feel like I'm in a board meeting. Y'all in favor? Anyone second her proposal? Discussion?
What was that? How do you want to collect the data?
Yeah,
I think that's what we should determine at the next.
Okay, at the next one.
Yeah, the next meeting.
So maybe
we'll do opportunities to respond. We can create templates. And
well, and Jeff, maybe Jeff, you could, if you know of any tools that are kind of out there that we could start from, could be how Jeff and Stephen will be our person next time.
That would be great if they could share that.
Yeah, like if there's any tools, and then we can refine.
Get a video, quick video.
And it's a tool to do what? What's the purpose of the tool again?
To be able to monitor, like once we start doing training with teachers to increase it, to be able to monitor like our baseline data and to see impact of the professional learning on classroom practice. So being able to go into classrooms and say, okay, right now we're at like 3 interactions in an hour class period. Now where are we at after 6 months of providing professional learning and coaching? Does that make sense?
Right. Okay. Well, and we can, Stephen and I can draft something and you guys can work with it, right? How does that sound?
That's lovely. Does that sound reasonable?
Unless you guys want to draft it. You guys can draft it too.
Nope. We would love for you to come with
they don't want to? Okay.
Point and we will add to it. That reasonable?
You guys have lots of extra time, right? Lots of extra time.
And not meant to give you work. If you don't have one available, then we can generate and you can help us do that. But if you have tools that you're aware of that we can leverage for this, that would be great.
And I wonder
then. Yeah, we got this.
Okay.
We could use this template to help us sort of come up with a framework.
Okay.
Because then we can teach from that framework, right? We have the instructional practices, the look force, the strategies, and the systems in place that we can speak to if we turn just this initial template into sort of a framework for guiding this work. And then that we could add later on other strategies and other pieces along the way.
Okay, we have two, I think, meaty things for next time. So December 4th, I hope you can join us. There'll be some good work occurring. We'll establish which strategies. Jeff has a lot of background and his colleague Stephen in this space around what are the academic strategies we could pick from. So they'll have that to offer for us. And then we can look at any samples of tools they already know that are available that we could take components of, or we could just refine one of them, or we might just love it and be like, call it good. But you do want to be able to measure your impact and be able to show teacher change. And that, even from a coaching perspective, the coach can be the one monitoring and just giving the teacher feedback like, wow, you offered 3 more opportunities than last time or whatever it might look like. Okay, we are going to wrap there. Jeff, thank you for your time this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nice meeting you guys.
And I will send the notes.
Cool.
Okay, thanks.
Bye.